Welcome back to On Your Computer with Kevin Gleason. That's me. And today we're going to be working with your effective use of the internet. But before we do the internet thing, I'd like to make sure that we have covered over just a very brief review of some very important aspects of working with the computer. One thing is the mouse. And last time around, I wanted to make sure that we understood. Again, with the mouse, there's a left mouse button right over there, a right mouse button right there. There's a wheel on here that might be on some of your mouses. They might not be. We'll talk about that in a few minutes' time. First of all, again, a click is a left mouse button being pressed one time. And typically what that does is it just highlights an image on the screen. Secondly, a double click. A double click is pressing the left mouse button twice in rapid succession. What that typically does is it opens up an application and it causes a new window to form on your desktop. The drag operation, which is holding down on the left mouse button while moving the mouse over a certain area of the screen. In effect, it changes the location of that object. It allows us to do resizing of an object, and again, moving it around so it fits better on the screen surface. There are additional terms that you should be aware of during this session. One of them is called a scroll. And a scroll is a document that may be larger than one's ability to view it all at one time. And there are controls that we'll be covering today that will talk about how to do that, how to tell whether or not there's something that's larger than what is seen on the screen. And another term that I'd like to go over with you is the word default. A default is a setting that has been set previously that can be changed. For example, you'll often hear me say, okay, we're going to accept the default, which means we're not going to do anything more other than run with the settings that are in the computer already. So again, double-clicking an icon means to start an application and to open up a new window on the desktop. The window has, or it can have, vertical and or horizontal scroll bars if its contents exceed the size of the window. I am going to double click on this Internet Explorer icon at the bottom of the screen. Again, I clicked on that twice in rapid succession. And off to the right hand side, I am going to change the size of this screen, make it a little bit smaller. In doing so, I've created a scroll box along the scroll bar on either side. There's a scroll arrow at the very top. Again, these will appear whenever the size of the image is larger than what is currently being viewed. What you can see from this image is that there's more below where the screen is showing right now. So it's the relationship between the scroll box, which is this larger gray area, and the lighter gray area that is used to indicate the relative location of our window on this screen. So the scroll box and the scroll bar are both an indicator, and at the same time, they're a control. Again, you can move the scroll box down the page by clicking on the scroll arrow. And likewise, you can drag this scroll box down the page again to see a sharper view, a quicker view. The scroll arrows will work a single line at a time. There's also another, as I mentioned earlier, the scroll wheel, which only controls the vertical positioning of the page. This works while my mouse pointer is on the page itself. And if I turn the wheel down, I can control the entire page. It's the same thing as moving and dragging the scroll box. Even though there might be a need to see something horizontally across the page, the scroll wheel will only work in one direction. either up or down. That's the vertical movement. There's a couple more terms I'd like to go over now before we begin working with the internet. A browser is an application that allows you to connect to the internet. There are two top browsers currently available. One is the Internet Explorer, that's by Microsoft, and the second one is Firefox by Mozilla. Those are two popular browsers, and right now we are working with the Internet Explorer. And again, this was the icon that we started down in the lower left-hand corner of the screen. The Mozilla Firefox is this other icon over here. You may or may not have both browsers on your computer. If you do, then you can open them either individually or at the same time. Sometimes I'll find myself using both browsers at the same time, one to check my email, another one to do a search. Another term that you should be aware of is called a PDF, or a portable document format. That's a format that was created by Adobe Systems about 20 years ago that's a standard for an open electronic document exchange. If you find yourself working with government forms, they are normally stored in a PDF format, which makes them visible just as they would appear on the printed page. They're available again on your computer, and we'll see that PDF working in a few minutes' time. And another term to be discussed is a download. There's something to be downloaded if you find it at a source or at a website and you want to make it available on your computer. We call downloading that. Additional terms is hypertext transport protocol. That's kind of a term that you will see basically appearing on pages, but what it really means is it's a combination of codes and methods that allows you to click on an object or click on a link and make several additional services available to you over the World Wide Web. Another term is cookies. A cookie is an internet tool that the browser maintains that tracks previous websites visited in case you want to return to them. That's slightly different from a bookmark, which we'll talk about in a minute's time. A cookie is typically a merchant device that allows merchants to target, market a product or a service. For example, let's say they were looking for taking a trip to Washington, D.C. You might go on to the internet and look on various prices for bus schedules and for airline tickets. The organization that you're looking at that maintains that website will make a notation on your computer that you came to this site and you're looking for that particular travel destination. The next time you log on to that website, the cookie will be read, and if the service provider has a special for you, they'll advertise that for you. They'll make that available on the computer screen. A bookmark, again, is very similar to something that you would have if you were reading a book. It's just basically you've gone to a page, you like it, you want to go back to that page, and you can return to that rather easily. Again, right now on the screen, we're looking at an Internet Explorer. On this site, the location, the internet address bar, is found up here. As you can see, it says HTTP, which again is the protocol for working with the various links on the page. It's followed by a colon, two forward slashes, and www.google.com. Just a word of note, anything that ends in a .com is a commercial site. Anything that ends in a .gov is a government site. So something that you might find again at tax time will probably be found at a .gov site. If you're perusing colleges or schools, you might find .edu. Again, these are just indicators and classifications for different websites. I'm going to put my mouse pointer on top of this address bar and click it once, and then type in www.norfolkcable.com. Press enter. Let's open this screen up a little bit further. So I'm going to drag the window over here. I'm going to grab a hold of a corner and widen this so I can see most of the page. Again, this is the website, and this is the one that represents the community television for Norfolk. Located along here, each of these are hyperlinks at the top of this web page. And locate, if you can, supplements and click on that once. As you can see on your computer with Kevin Gleason, let's use the scroll wheel to bring this down. And as you can see, for show number one, powering on and powering off, that was the first show that we did last time. Locate, if you will, this link just beneath that that says on your computer show number one and click that once. What this will do is it will open up a PDF file, and this is the supplemental handout. Some folks tell me when they watch the show that they prefer to have something in hand as they are reading along. And again, this gives you something. It's supplemental material that may or may not have been covered adequately in the first show. There's also one for show number two further on down that page. Using the skills that you've already seen before, you can see that the scroll box up here, and there's a long space just beneath that. There's approximately 8 pages of text that is available here, and I can scroll down them either just by dragging or by using the scroll wheel, and so on and so forth. I'm going to return this to the top of the page, not that we have to, but just as a matter of my procedure. And I'm going to close this window off. And if you will recall last time around, we used the X in the upper right-hand corner to close the application. You've just been exposed to your first web page on the computer. Again, these web pages are typically for your benefit. They might be selling you something, or they might be used for explanation. Okay, moving along, let's open up another browser. This time, let's open up the Firefox browser. So I'm going to click on it. That's a double click. I'm going to expand this out a little bit further. Now, the address bar on the Firefox website is located right up here. It says go to a website. We're going to click on that once and then type in www.whitehouse.gov and then press enter. The typical assumption, the default assumption here, is HTTP, which doesn't have to be entered all the time. It may from time to time, and I'll let you know when. Here we're looking at the White House website. Again, at the very top of the page, there is a hyperlink for blog, another one for photos and video, another one for briefing room, issues, the administration, and so on and so forth. You can tell by looking at this thing that we're not looking at the entire page. That is by the scroll box inside the scroll bar over here to the right-hand side. Again, we're probably looking at maybe one quarter, maybe a third of the entire web page. So I can either drag this down or else I can use the scroll wheel. And again, if the size of the page was wider than what was available on the screen, then we would get a horizontal scroll bar. Let me see if I can cause that size of the screen down a little bit smaller. You can see both there's something missing from this page or this side of the page. There's also something across the bottom that's missing. Horizontal scroll bar inside the scroll box inside the scroll bar. By dragging that over, I can see what is to the right of what is currently available. And again, let me drag this off the right-hand side. And I'm going to keep this window open for a minute longer. This time I'm going to open up another browser. Let me go down and open up a Internet Explorer. Again, with Internet Explorer, the home page is Google, which is a search engine, which allows you to type in a given phrase down here and then press enter, and the computer will come back with pages for you to further investigate. Let me make this screen a little bit smaller. So right now we have two browsers on the screen at the same time. One more thing I'd like to explore right now is something called a blog, or a web log for short. We call it a blog. It's a noun. It's a website which an individual or group of users record opinions, information, etc. on a regular basis. Another definition for this is a website that contains an online personal journal with reflections, comments, and often hyperlinks provided by the writer. There happens to be one for this computer show. That would be found here. So I'm going to click on this internet address bar, and I'm going to type in http://onyourcomputer.wordpress.com. And here we have the blog for the On Your Computer cable TV series. Okay. And again, take a look at this at your convenience. Again, there are comments on here. There are some suggestions on here. Kind of gives you a sense of where we're going with this series. Okay. Also gives you an opportunity of contributing to the series as well and making your thoughts available as well. For time being, let me just create a bookmark for this. You'll notice up in the on this blue area at the very top of the screen, just underneath those three controls, there's a picture of a house. The picture of the house is your home page, which if you clicked on it, would bring you back to the Google web search. Just next to it, there's a star. I'm going to click on the star, and this is going to allow me the capability of adding this page, this bookmark, to the... So I'm going to add or click on the Add to Favorites, and I'm given the dialog box down here. It says Add to Favorite, and I'm going to add the following to the favorite page on your computer today. One thing I'd like to do is I might want to come back to this later on. So let me create a new folder. So I'm going to click on New Folder, and I want this new folder to be called Blogs, B-L-O-G-S. I'm going to create that, and then I'm going to add What's on Your Computer Today, that web page, to my blog subheading by clicking the Add button. Next, let me go back to my home page, which is the Google page. And lastly, let me go over and click on this star. And when I click on it, it'll give me my favorite pages. And at the very bottom, it'll be a blogs heading. If I click on that, and just beneath that, you'll see a new page has been added. What's on your computer today? If I click on that, I'll be returned immediately back to the blog page, as mentioned earlier. A discussion on accessing the internet would not be complete without a look at identity theft due to insecure passwords. The following film clip presents Crackers.
Jim, how do I get into that system? I want to play those games.
You're not supposed to see any of that stuff. That system probably contains a new data encryption algorithm. You'll never get in there.
Hey, I don't believe that any system is totally secure.
Distinction with hackers and crackers. A hacker is looks at systems and software and for vulnerabilities and with the intention of improving them or educating us. A cracker, on the other hand, attempts to break into a system with a software with malicious intents. A hacker is like a night watchman checking locks for their secureness and reporting on potential breaches, whereas a cracker uses specialized tools to either enter and or steal, disrupt, or destroy. We are pleased that Paul Hayes can join us to speak on password security. Paul was the former police chief for Hanover, Massachusetts, and is a professor at Curry College and instructor at Massachusetts Criminal Justice Training Council.
So well, when you look at passwords, Kevin, you look at them like a house key. You wouldn't go out and leave for a long period of time and leave your house unlocked, particularly if you lived in an environment where you knew that it's possible that someone would be trying to enter that house when you weren't at home. So the key to any type of security is knowing how to secure your property. And that's for your house, it's for your computer, it's for your work, no matter what environment you're in. But particularly with computers, we find that password security is probably one of the least items on a agenda list for individuals to take care of. So they become very vulnerable to password security and individuals who are trying to get into those computers. Most people have one or two passwords. Some have multiple passwords. The difference between the individuals with one or two passwords is most of those individuals feel secure with that particular password because they've never had a problem with it. Well, they may have never had a problem with it only for the fact that someone hasn't tried to get into whatever environment that password is protecting. And as we start looking at password protection, the greater the knowledge of the individual of how to secure their password and what to do to have a password that is pretty invulnerable, that is probably what this program's about today. As we look at password security, I think as long as individuals have a password that hasn't been broken into, they feel secure. We have individuals, both in a business environment and a personal environment, that use 3, 4, 5 characters. It may be a phrase that they know. It may be a pet's name. It may be their mother's maiden name. It could be any type of knowledgeable information that that user can readily remember. Unfortunately, with that type of information, generally that is very easy to hack into as well. It's not generally a secure password. As we start looking into passwords that are secure, we see the longer the password and the more variables put into the password, the more difficult it is to hack into. If you are using a particular phrase that seems common to you, it's probably common to someone else. And if you're using a particular word or particular algorithm that you're putting in there that is easy to remember, it's probably easy for someone else to hack into as well. So the key to success with password protection is make it as variable as possible, yet still comfortable for you to remember.
Would you use a combination of letters and numbers? Or
I think the more variables, the more secure your password would be. The more variables, meaning that lowercase, uppercase, numbers, different asterisks, signs, and symbols, which would change the password. But once again, you need something that you're going to be able to remember. I think a lot of individuals, when we start asking about password protection, they use something that will be very easy to remember. So if you're changing a password, you obviously want something that's easy to remember. So you need to be able to find something in your own knowledge that works for you.
And so you're suggesting a passphrase?
A passphrase is a common way to be able to utilize a very secure password protection. Or if it's not a password, it's not a phrase that you're using for a password, perhaps you may want to think of something else that may be something that you're utilizing in your own life. Maybe a different number combination. A lot of times in our lives, we have locker combinations that we use at the health club, or we may have a combination that we use for something else in our own personal lives. Maybe it's a lock or a key somewhere that we're utilizing, and that has a series of numbers. So maybe what you want to do with that, you may take your mother's initials. My mother would be RH, so I'd have R18-24-35. -H. So that's a locker combination, but to have a password such as that, it's going to be very difficult for someone to get into. But I'm always going to remember my mother's first name and last name, and I'm always going to remember that combination that I have to a padlock that's located at a health club that I go to. So things that you need to remember that you normally would be using, but just throw little variables into them. That's the key to success. There's a password protection area of the computer where you can go in and determine how secure your actual password would be. But for the most part, I think the more complicated it is, at least for someone to get into it, the more secure you are. But it shouldn't be complicated for you to remember.
Now, there's a site that you presented to us that would help us to check on the securedness of our passwords. And that site is howsecureismypassword.net. And again, this site will be displayed on the screen. Typing in various passwords into the this gray area, we can check and see how secure they are. For example, J-E-L-L-Y-F-I-S-H. Okay, that can be broken into in about 22 minutes' time. Let's go back and change the letters a little bit and put in a J-E-L-L-Y with the numbers 22 and the letters fish. And we've just changed the time to break in to a year. So as you can see, just taking simple words, even though they are words from the dictionary, and inserting numbers or other special symbols, we can change the likelihood of it being broken into. Let's take another one, and we'll take a look at, Dr. House, D-O-C-T-O-R-H-O-U-S-E. It can be broken into in 10 days. Now, if we take the same password and go with a capital D, lowercase O-C-T, the number 0, the letter R for OR, capital H, 0, U-S-E. Again, you're substituting various characters that look like the words Dr. House. And now we're finding that this same password with a combination of uppercase and lowercase letters and numbers, we're talking 412 years. Just a simple period at the very end of that. We've just changed this to 631,000 years. Okay, so again, the use of combinations, and these are just using basic words directly from the dictionary, but just by adding numbers, uppercase, lowercase, and punctuation, you can greatly increase your password that much more secure. Any other thoughts on the matter of...
Once you've been hacked, you have lost all that information, you have no idea where it may have wound up, who has access to it at that point, and now you're in a quandary of what do you do with all the information that you have on your computer, your laptop or your tablet, or on your iPhone, and how much information did they steal and what are they going to do with it?
Thank you for joining us for today's show, and we hope you'll come back next time and watch On Your Computer with Kevin Gleason.